So, hi everyone. My name is Björn. Björn Kiminich, actually, but never mind. So I'm the Juice Shop guy. So I'm the project lead and also the main developer of the Juice Shop. So first question, who used the Juice Shop already? Okay, that's quite a few, but not all. So I hope I will not bore the ones familiar with it too much. So what I want to do, I want to give you an introduction what the Juice Shop is and what you can do with it, and also show off our new user interface, because in the screenshots or in the demo from David, we actually saw the old user interface, and now you get to know the new one. So let's start. So why is it called Juice Shop? If you know German, then you might know the term Saftladen, which is a shop which offers a really bad shopping experience. So everyone who's working there is very unfriendly. The products are typically broken, and it's not fun going there. So it's a dump. And that word was split apart into Saft and Laden, and if you translate it back, then you end up with Juice Shop, which is pretty hard to pronounce, especially to the American guys, I've learned. So they actually call it Juice Box sometimes. But the official project name is Juice Shop. The fact that JS stands for JavaScript is purely coincidental, and that's not even a joke. That's actually true. I didn't realize this connection unless when I started looking for a logo. So instead of showing just fancy slides, let's start with a little live shopping tour. So this is a Juice Shop. And let's zoom in a bit. Hope that's okay. So it has everything that an e-commerce application needs. Starting with a cookie banner, right? So, we're all interested in what the cookie banner says actually, right? So let's see. And then we will also learn if the sound works. Okay, cookies work. So let's close that. Okay, so let's pretend we're just some regular customer who visits the Juice Shop for the first time, enjoyed the cookie video, and then wants to do some shopping. So I think, well, we can look through the different items that are offered here. So let's see, what do we have? Oh, merchandise. Merchandise is good. So, like, here's a mug, for example. Well, nice. There's tattoos, actually. Those actually exist, so you can buy those. Unfortunately, I don't have any with me anymore because I all gave them away in the last conference. But as you can see from this customer review, they are really, really cool. So, okay, what else do we have? Of course, also some juice products, like, for example, raspberry juice, very tasty. So there's all kinds of stuff you can buy. Well, to buy, you actually need to have an account, right? So, and then you have two options how to register. So you can click on this link here, and then you can do the classic way, right? Email, password, da da da. Awesome security question, right? We love those. Or we can try the more fancy way with an actual OAuth integration with Google. So let's see if that works. I'm not sure if I want to type in my password right now. Well, let's do the classic way. User registration. Okay, so björn@oasp.org. Perfect. Okay, secret question. Okay, what do we pick? Name of your favorite pet. Okay, we have a very sweet family cat, which has only three legs. She's totally adorable. So I just take her name because it's a perfectly safe answer to the security question, I guess. So let's copy this for later and register. Now let's see if I can log in. That looks good. Here we go. So let's see. Ah, we have a new user profile page, actually, which looks a little bit weird. Not sure if it's written in the same technology like the rest of the application, but, well, never mind. Let's go back. So let's do some shopping. I definitely want some of these fancy tattoos. So let's put some in the basket. I also want a mug, and I also want, let's say, a raspberry juice. So let's see your basket. Well, you can do the obvious things you would expect here, right? So like add more stuff. Doesn't go below zero because it's perfectly validating the number of things. Not what David told you in the last session, that doesn't actually work. So let's take out the raspberry juice and okay, so let's check out. Oh no. Wait a second. There's a gift button here, right? Down here, and also a button with a credit card. So when you click on the gift button, you're actually allowed to enter a coupon code. Okay, so let's try that. Invalid. Okay. But maybe we can find a coupon code on Twitter. So let's see. I opened that up here already. So let's see. Coupons. This looks good, doesn't it? 50%, that's a lot. So let's see if that works. Yay! So, great. Then, what do we have here? Okay, it's an open source project, it's part of OWASP, so it can always use money so that we can get more stickers to distribute or more new t-shirts if I mine shrink too much when washing them or whatever. Then, so that's for the donation part. We don't need that right now. Let's check out. So, let's see. Oh, beautiful, right? So, there's the invoice. Nice PDF, and actually, 50% discount, including rounding error. That's free. Great. Awesome. Well, it's JavaScript, right? I mean, what would you expect? Okay. So let's copy the order number and go back and just try out one other use case, which is pretty new. Track orders. So you can put in an order number here and it will actually tell you when your order will arrive. Isn't that amazing? So in 4 days, I will get my temporary tattoos and my market. Maybe. So, okay, that's great. What else do we have? We have language selection. So we have actually a lot of different translations in the juice shop already. Of course, you can search for stuff. Well, the obvious. We have an About Us page with a fancy slider where all the customer feedback is being shown, with social links, everything you actually need, right? You can write some feedback, and then you have to solve a complicated captcha. So let's try that. Hello. So 5 stars. And that is... I hope that's right. Yes. Okay. So let's see. And here's my hello. Okay. So now I roughly used everything that the juice shop has to offer. So most of it at least. So that's, as you can see, it works like it should, right? Like you would expect from a web shop. But obviously it's not, of course, this is not all. It's not just some nice, template applications for developers who want to write their own web shop. Actually, nobody should ever use it as a template for writing their own application because it's, of course, horribly broken. So, but first, let's see. So if you want to run the juice shop on your own, on your computer, you can choose between tons of different options. So starting with local Node.js installation or Docker container, whatever you like. You can also put it on different cloud platforms, and we have actually quite good documentation how to do each of those. So the main idea of the juice shop, of course, is to teach people, mostly developers or also QA, different web security issues, right? So that's why the juice shop contains, at the moment, 73 different hacking challenges of different categories. And it's everyone's job to find those, right? Those challenges have, let's say, different difficulties. So there are in total 6 different levels, from very easy to really, really mind-bogglingly hard. And yeah, there's something in it for everybody. And one of the most interesting features of the Juice Shop actually is that it keeps track of whatever you're doing. So if you are hacking, doing a successful cross-site scripting attack, for example, it will recognize it and will give you feedback and will show you on a scoreboard that you did something right. And I will show this instead of showing the slides here. So I already unlocked the scoreboard, although normally it's a challenge to actually find it, right? So the scoreboard is not advertised anywhere. Well, maybe it is, but it's not immediately visible in the user interface. So, but I unlocked the button already, so we can take a look what is in there. So as you can see, there's 6 levels of difficulty here, different categories, and you have all kinds of things you can do, like XSS and finding some administration section and some login challenges where you try to log in as a different user, for example. Also, SQL injection, some tampering with products, more cross-site scripting, XXE. Then the harder ones, well, there's no SQL injection in different levels. There's typo squatting, bypassing this amazing capture from the comment section. That's also one of the harder challenges. What else do we have? Password reset, beating the password reset. So trying to find the answer to my security question, which in the account that comes with the Juice Shop, which belongs to me, is not the name of my pet, actually. It's a bit harder. And then the most recent additions to the Juice Shop have been server-side request forgery and some server-side template injection challenges, which are really, really, really hard. Even I don't know how they work, because someone else actually wrote them, and they are too hard even for me. So let's solve one of the easier challenges. So let's do one of the cross-site scriptings. So if you take this attack string here, and you are able to do a successful reflected or DOM-based XSS, then you should get this thing here solved. And as you can see in the scoreboard, it actually gives you a little hint if you hover over the unsolved button. So the obvious place to try that, right, is of course in the search field. So let's do it. What a surprise. And now the interesting thing is that the Juice Shop recognized it immediately, and it gives you an instant notification that you solved some challenge, which is pretty useful because you know that you did something right, and that's actually quite helpful. And in the scoreboard, this should now also be rendered as solved. So if you're asking yourself, well, what happens if my server crashes or I need to make a break for a longer time. So I want to shut down my computer and I want to continue tomorrow maybe. Well, can I do that or will all my challenges be lost? Well, the good thing is if you kill your server, let's just do that. Now it's down and you restart it. Then after the restart period, it should actually recover all your solved challenges from before. So let's see if it works. Takes a few seconds to actually launch all the scripts. Okay, that looks good. It's listening. And here we go. The server just restarted and it tells you, okay, you did this already. So here you go. You can see the challenge is solved again. If you want to restart, then you can clean this cookie, which stores your progress as well, of course. So that's pretty neat. But there's something that's even cooler than this. You can use the Juice Shop in Capture the Flag events, which is pretty nice. And I mean, it's 73 challenges. So what you would have to do, you have to use the Juice Shop, and then you can you could set up a CTF server manually by copying and pasting all the challenges into that CTF server, which is quite annoying, which is why the Juice Shop team actually offers a little plugin, a little tool, which helps you do this kind of setup much faster. So all you have to do is you need to find your favorite CTF server. In this case, I'm using CTFD, and this is just plain installation of CTFD 1.2 with no challenges, nothing in it yet. Okay? So it's black. Now I installed a little tool, which is called Juice Shop CTF. And if you run that, it will start asking in a moment different questions about the CTF you want to set up. So it asks you, okay, which server do you want to use? So, and I want to use CTFD. Then it asks you for a URL where it can retrieve the actual hacking challenges, right? So I'm using the default instance. I could also point it to my local running instance, but it doesn't matter at the moment because it's the same version. So let's use this one. You can define a key file for the CTF so that solutions, solution codes that are being generated differ from other setups, right? So you don't always have the same solutions for the same challenges. Might be interesting if you use it at a university, for example, and you don't want students from class A to cheat by using the solutions from class B, right? And you can choose how you want to deal with hints. So if you want to have no hints at all, or if there should be free, or if people have to pay with points. So let's make the text hints free and the URL hints paid. And now it generates a zip file with the corresponding data, and that you can now import into CTFD. So that's the one I just created. Yeah, there's one from yesterday, just in case something breaks. So, and we only want the challenges, and hit import. And let's see what happens. Okay, so let's see. When we go to the challenges now, we have 73 challenges automatically imported with scores and everything. So let's look at it from the participant's point of view. Would look like this. So for example, finding the scoreboard down here. You can click on it. You get the description. You can view the hint if you like. Right? Or you, if you would have already some points, you could pay for the, for even more hints. So now we would like to solve it, obviously. But I don't have any of these flag codes, right? So to get those, you need to, run the Juice Shop in a different mode, which you can specify as a simple environment variable. In this case, it's CTF. And let's see how this changes the behavior. All right. So, and as you can see, now the solution messages contain this flag code, right? And I can copy this one for the scoreboard and paste it in here. And now it's solved, right? And I get 100 points. So if you're familiar with the setup, then it takes like 5 minutes to actually complete this, which is pretty fast for a CTF preparation, I would say. So in the Juice Shop, everyone needs to use their own installation, right? So every participant of the CTF has their own Juice Shop instance. The only thing they share is the CTF server in the middle and this key file which generates the flags. So if you want, you can also run this setup tool, which asks the nice questions with some configuration files. So you could, in theory, completely automate this whole setup with some, I don't know, some Ansible scripts or whatever, and then you can have your whole CTF environment up in by just running a simple script. Okay. So what else do we have? The Juice Shop also has a quiet mode. I won't show that because it's quite simple. It doesn't show any notifications. Why would you want that? Well, in some situations when you're, for example, teaching IT managers about vulnerabilities and you just want to demonstrate them, right? You don't want these messages to pop up because that wouldn't actually happen in a real application. So it might just confuse them. So you can turn those off. Thinking about teaching managers, actually managers tend to have a, managers of regular companies have a problem sometimes relating to this whole juice shop theme, right? Because, let's say you are working for an insurance company, in management, you cannot really relate to this use case of selling juice on the web, right? You don't do that. It would be nice to actually be able to put your own, corporate layout and own products into the juice shop instead, right? So, well, we have that covered as well. So let me just show you quickly one theme that was used at Mozilla for an actual CTF event. So if I refresh this, different color scheme, as you can see, different products with different descriptions. It even has different Twitter links. So it's basically it's very flexible. You can customize almost everything. You cannot completely hide the fact that this is a juice shop application, but that's not the main point, right? So the main point is it should look like something that the people you're doing the training with or doing the awareness session with is something that they actually can relate to. So out of nostalgia, let me show you one other theme which I really like. And here we go. So this is the budget store version of the juice shop, right? With the original I rewrote the generator code for the names or for the descriptions and for the names in JavaScript. So it's really the exact same stuff. Okay, good. So behind the scenes, this is, of course, a little bit more modern than the budget store. So we have with the latest version, we have an Angular 7 front end using Material Design as a UI framework. There's Node.js in the back end with Express as the main routing framework, basically. We're using a SQLite database, which is included in the application itself. So it's file-based, so there's no need to host a separate database server or anything. That's also the reason why there's only one Docker image that you need and not like a Docker Compose setup, which might be more complicated for you to run. And, well, then there's SQLize doing the mapping. And we even have a NoSQL database, which is running in memory, which is MassDB, which is a JavaScript implementation of a MongoDB. And if this sounds like a bad idea to you, you're right. Okay. So the language support of the juice shop is growing by the day, I would say. Actually, just yesterday, someone offered me to write a Korean translation, and I added this to our translation cloud platform, and he already translated half of the juice shop into Korean. So this is all the complete translations we have, and we have also some partial ones available already. Even more behind the scenes, while the juice shop is really broken, right, with so many vulnerabilities, but to make sure that it actually works, it needs a lot of testing. And I'm a big fan of test automation and this test pyramid idea of having a lot of unit tests, some integration tests, a small number of end-to-end tests, and then almost no manual testing. Because manual testing, that's this guy, is not so fun, right? If you want to do a release, you don't want to have to retest everything completely. So that's why the juice shop uses, on all levels, from end-to-end down to unit tests, a lot of different technologies and frameworks to make sure that it actually is as broken as it should be, but not more broken than that. Also, on the delivery part, I think juice shop is pretty advanced. So it's almost completely automated, the whole release process. with continuous integration, continuous deployment. And basically the only thing I have to do manually when I'm doing a release is on the GitHub release page, click on edit and then on publish, because that's the only way the SourceForge plugin triggers to actually put the deployables on SourceForge. And there are actually some people downloading the Juice Shop from SourceForge. I have no idea why, but some people actually do. Because it's available on GitHub as well, right? Okay, some common questions that I often hear. So, when you're using the Juice Shop, can you use your pen testing toys? Yes, you can. Everything you have. Right? You can use Zap, you can use Burp. You can use all the expensive tools from big vendors that you might have bought. They might not help much, but you can, of course, use them. Can I do a white box pen test? No, please don't. Because once you look into the underlying source code on GitHub, I mean, somehow I need to check if you solved a hacking challenge, right? And if you understand how that check works, then you can basically reproduce the solution without actually understanding the vulnerability. So this is simple cheating, but it doesn't really help you in learning and training anything. Can you use the internet? So of course you can. There's actually a lot of challenges which rely on some internet research. For example, breaking into someone's account by resetting his password, you might first have to find out who that person actually is and maybe do some research on that person to actually find out what the answer to his or her question might be. Okay, if the installation doesn't work, I think the documentation is pretty good, so it should actually be covered. If it's not, then well, you can always ask for help in the community chat or on Slack, or you can even use our mailing list, which has 3 or 4 subscribers, including myself. So this is how modern the Juice Shop is, right? We offer a mailing list which nobody uses because they all go to Slack and Gitter instead. Okay, if you crash the server, you just restart. It doesn't only give you back the challenges, but it also wipes everything you changed in the database. So if you, for example, if you added some user account, which now messes up your user interface due to some weird XSS you built in, just restart the server and it will be gone. If you're stuck, I recommend to download this little companion guide ebook, which is also free, like the Juice Shop is. You can also read it online on Gitbook. It has setup instructions. It explains in detail how to set up a CTF, how to do this customization that I just showed, and it gives a complete walkthrough through every single challenge. Disclaimer, the book at this moment is still on version 7 point something, right? And what I just showed is 8 point something. So some of the challenge solution changed a bit with the latest UI. So some of the solutions here in the book might not work as they are described, but they would still give you some idea where to look. I hope this will be rewritten by end of the year, but no promises. So sometimes people find other vulnerabilities which are not meant to be there, and then it would be nice if you reported them, and then I have basically 2 options. I can try to fix those, or I can try to write a challenge around it. I prefer the letter, but sometimes it doesn't work, right? So always report things that don't work like they should, which are not giving you a green notification when you actually do them. Also, just recently, I started disabling some challenges in certain environments. And people are asking me, yeah, why did you do this? So I realized that the XXE, so the XML-based challenges, mess up Docker containers. So if you do certain attack payloads, the Docker container crashes completely. And it's totally fine on a local node installation. That doesn't really matter. But in a container environment, I'm not really sure what kind of side effects this might actually have. So I'm turning a few challenges off by default, There is some kind of override switch in the configuration where you can say, okay, I don't care, I want everything, and I, on my own risk, I also want XXE on my Docker instance. So, if you want to contribute to the project, well, of course you can do so by sending a pull request to GitHub. The best issues on GitHub for beginners are the ones marked with good first issue, and the ones where I actually would be really grateful for help are the help wanted labels. So in the best case, you find an issue which has both these labels. That's great if you help with those. Also, we always like to have new translations, so if you know some language which is not yet covered, feel free to contact me and I will gladly add it. Of course, there's rewards for doing contributions. I think that's one of the main unique selling points of the Juice Shop project, that it, right from the beginning, I sent out thank you packages with stickers and other stuff to people for their first merge pull request, which is really a successful concept. So as we have not only stickers by now, but also, as I said, tattoos and magnets and all kinds of other fancy things, do a pull request and you get a little thank you package from me. Okay, so let's refresh that. So this is the last pyramid I'm showing. So the Juice Shop has in total 39 contributors over the time. It's by now a flagship project since this year. And I think in the lower part of the pyramid, it's rounded, right? So it has 1,500 something stars, which is now rounded up to 2K, which is nice. Over 10,000 downloads combined between GitHub and SourceForge. And this, which is, it says it has 3 million pulls of the Docker image, right? When I was at the German OWASP Day 2 weeks ago, it was still at 2.something million. I have no idea what you people are doing, but someone needs to have some botnet running that just stupidly pulls Juice Shop images for no reason. I don't believe there's so many security experts in the world that actually need so many Juice Shop instances. But keep doing that, because it looks really nice on the slides. Okay, project roadmap. So things coming up next. As we just did our next major release, there's not so much on the list. What I would be really grateful for is someone with some UI user experience expertise helping out with some of our recent of our open design issues. So that would be great. At the moment, we are looking at some universities in Germany to see if we can maybe set up some student project that can then deal with this. And one feature that I would really like to see is the hacking instructor. Let's see if I can open that link. So the idea of the hacking instructor is that you can turn it on, and then, like Clippy back in the days, right? Some little helpful companion shows up and gives you some hints on what you're supposed to do. In this case, for the cross-site scripting thing, it will tell you, okay, you might go to the search box and try it out. Okay, and then, you can search for something, and it will then tell you, oh, great, now please try something else, because, it's shown on the screen, which is always good when things you put in are shown on the screen afterwards, right? So it might actually give you the hint to search for something more malicious, right? And then see what happens. So you're slowly guided toward the challenge, and whenever you're done, the companion goes back to the corner and you can get it back. And yeah, I had some ideas how this could be configured, but this is just some very, very high level ideas from beginning of this year, I guess. So, someone who would like to help with that is very, very welcome. Okay, so when will this be done? As always, when it's done, which is typically earlier than I promised, but not always. Okay, so here's some links to the main project. We have a very nice vanity URL. So OWASP-juice.shop is our vanity URL. It's traditionally without HTTPS, of course. It only forwards to other pages. Most of them are secure then. This is all the GitHub repositories related to the Juice Shop, including the ebook content. And if you're interested, I also have some training and some university lecture as Creative Commons content online. If that's something you might want to steal some slides from, feel free to do so. And now there would be some time for questions. Unless you want to get some post-credits bonus content. So this is a little story. So I had an interview with a 7-Minute Security podcast. I don't know, anybody listens to that? Nobody. Okay. So it's a smaller podcast based in the US. And the podcaster is a really nice guy. And he's always doing a little bit of singing and in at the beginning of his show. So when we did the interview and we finished, we realized, for I don't know what reason, that hey, wouldn't it be nice if the Juice Shop actually had a commercial jingle, right? And the podcaster Brian actually promised to do that for the German OWASP Day. He kind of botched the timeline, so he only had time to in like one day to come up with some pre-alpha version, which I played on the German OWASP Day, and now for the second time live, also here. Let's see if it works.
When you wanna shop online, then you had better be sure the experience is safe and also secure. Don't wanna let no SQLi or cross-site scripting ruin your day. No, you wanna break into a joyous song and say, Juice Shop, you can order tasty beverages in any quantity. Juice Shop, just don't test the site with Burp Suite or you won't like what you see.
So I hope the full album will be available on iTunes sometime next year with dance remixes and everything that you would expect. Let's see how many stars we can gather to actually help build this content. So, and of course, it's not done yet, but it will happen. Finding this sound file of the alpha version will become a challenge in the Juice Shop, obviously. And I will probably also take the lyrics into a text file and hide that as well. So that's two more challenges for actually no good reason, but it's just fun, right? Okay, now that's it. Any questions?
Who wants it? Question where?
Don't hit the camera.
Thank you for the presentation. Sometimes they say German don't have humor, but that's a prejudice.
I'm trying to prove the opposite, yeah.
Yes, good presentation. No, just maybe an obvious remark. What I see, will this be available as a cloud service as well?
You mean as a running hosted cloud service?
Yeah,
no,
like
you would have to host it on your own.
Okay.
So, but there's instructions how you can run the Docker image easily in your Amazon or Azure cloud. There's actually two instances on Heroku, which I have permanently running, but they're just demo instances.
Okay.
And I have written somewhere in the README that they are not supposed to be hacked. But for some reason, the scoreboard is always like at 30, 40, 50%. So I don't know what people are doing, but they clearly don't read my README.
Okay, great. Yeah, thanks for the answer. Yeah.
I've seen other similar projects with OWASP before, for example, the Acme Bank and the WebGoat. Mm-hmm. What are the similarities or the difference with this project?
To the Acme Bank, I don't know, but between WebGoat and JuiceShop, the main difference is that WebGoat doesn't try to be a realistic application, right? It's a lesson-based learning platform, I would say. Right, so you are guided step by step through different sets of challenges, and the JuiceShop really tries to be a realistic, fully working application with realistic vulnerabilities and some silly, funny Easter eggs. But the JuiceShop tries to keep up with the emerging and evolving technology. That's, I guess, one of the biggest differences. Because I don't know any other vulnerable web app which is using Angular 7 as a front end yet.
Okay, thank you.
In the darkness.
I have a question about the I had a memory hole, sorry. Both challenges, yes.
Okay.
So, does the JuiceShop actually, Docker image should be, have access to the internet in order to be able to fix them or to find them, all these challenges?
No, you run the JuiceShop completely isolated. You don't need internet access to solve the challenges. What you need to be able to perform some internet research in parallel for some of the solutions. But there's no checks that are actually depending on something on the internet running. Although there are some ideas to change even that. So I would, for example, really like to have some dependency on some serverless function, for example, that could then be broken, or even to have some Amazon Echo skill where you can, which could also be written in some broken way. Then there would be a dependency, yes. But at the moment, there's none. Welcome.